It was a different time in the 1980s, as proponents of 1950s social values had been given a second chance in the form of the Reagan presidency. As such, entertainment was starting to change. The 80s ushered in a new era of music consumption propagated by MTV.
Turn it on. Leave it on. America, see the music you want to see.
I want my MTV!
24 hours a day on cable TV.
Yeah, too much is never enough.
A cable TV channel specially dedicated to music videos of popular artists, which proved to blur the perceptive distinction between the audio and the visuals of music. Thus, the suggestive nature of some music successfully made the transition into video form. In addition, the heavy metal genre also began growing in popularity, and the lyrics regularly addressed darker themes, such as death and violence, as well as sex. With more artists expressing themselves more freely and more explicitly with minimal restrictions, a small group of politically connected women decided to take matters into their own hands and do their part to protect children from the allegedly harmful music of the 80s. These women are known as the Washington Wives, consisting of Tipper Gore, wife of Senator Al Gore, Susan Baker, wife of Treasury Secretary James Baker, Pam Hauer, wife of Washington Realtor Raymond Hauer, and Sally Nevius, wife of former Washington City Council Chairman John Nevius. It all started in 1984 when Tipper Gore purchased the Purple Rain album by Prince for her then 11-year-old daughter. They were listening to the album up until the track Darling Nikki, which featured these lyrics.
I met a girl named Nikki. Guess you could say she was a sex fiend. I met her in a hotel lobby, masturbating with a magazine.
Offended by the lyrics, Gore felt that this music was not appropriate for her child and attempted to return the album, disregarding the fact that it was already opened and played. Candy Stroud had a similar experience with her then 15-year-old daughter when they were listening to Darling Nikki, while Susan Baker was questioned by her then 7-year-old daughter about the lyrical contents in Madonna's Like a Virgin. This led Baker to examine the current state of popular music, who, before this uncomfortable encounter, was unaware that such arguably inappropriate material was readily available for consumption by adolescents. Tipper Gore also began doing research of her own and examined the music videos on MTV. She claimed that the music, as well as the videos accompanying the music, frightened her and would potentially frighten children. In 1985, she got in contact with Susan Baker and other concerned mothers who had similar experiences, namely Pam Hauer and Sally Nevius. All of these women shared the concern that parents are often unaware of the nature of the music in which their children listen to, and discussed the possible introduction of a rating system similar to the MPAA to increase consumer awareness.
But as parents, we believe we have a right to some consumer guidance in our effort to protect our own children from material that we believe may be inappropriate for them.
On May 13th, 1985, the Washington Wives, along with 20 other participants, most of whom consisted of other women tied to Washington, formed the Parents Music Resource Center, or PMRC for short. Their mission was to raise parental awareness of the growing trend in music towards lyrics that are sexually explicit, excessively violent, or glorified the use of drugs and alcohol. In addition to the music rating system, the PMRC made many other suggestions to the RIAA, including printing warnings and lyrics on album covers, forcing record stores to put albums with explicit covers under the counters, and pressuring radio and television stations not to broadcast explicit songs or videos. They also suggested that record labels reassess the contracts of musicians who performed violently or sexually in concert. With regard to the suggested music rating system, the PMRC devised their own rating system: X for profane or sexually explicit lyrics, V for violence, D/A for drugs and alcohol, and O for occult. As the PMRC were a nonprofit organization, they could not lobby for government-mandated rating system legislation. Consequently, the PMRC formed an alliance with the National PTA, which had already been strongly encouraging the introduction of a music rating system for several years. To better highlight the extremities of obscenity, the PMRC compiled a list of 15 songs they deemed offensive. And on this list, there was the previously mentioned Darling Nikki by Prince. Also on the Filthy 15 list is Cyndi Lauper's She Bop, which dealt with the subject matter of female masturbation. However, this is actually a double entendre, as Lauper said that she wanted children to think that the song was about dancing and to understand the real meaning as they got older. it was able to receive airplay as she never directly stated in the song what the meaning was. Another song on the list is Sheena Easton's Sugar Walls, which alluded to her, and how shall I put this, her middle region, which was perhaps sufficiently subtle by itself, but the general content was considered suggestive enough to qualify the song for the list.
Artists are just saying, hey, lighten up, get off our case. This is what art's all about, is being free. And if you don't like it, then turn into something else. You know, like, go watch the news and watch violence if you don't like sexuality.
Elvis swung his hips, but he said, I want you, I need you, I love you. It was somewhat romantic, the themes of his songs. Sheena Easton sings, come inside my sugar walls.
Funny how Tipper Gore says that, because even in the 50s, rock and roll was openly condemned by preachers and conservatives, especially Elvis Presley.
A contributing factor to our juvenile delinquency of today.
His dance moves were perceived as sexually suggestive, and his performances were frequently branded as obscene and vulgar. Even his records were proclaimed as devil's music. Presley stated in an interview with TV Guide in 1956 that his dance moves are not vulgar in any way, nor was he trying to sell sex. He jumped around the way he did to get in rhythm with the music, because he enjoyed doing it. Nonetheless, he was often reprimanded by local municipalities and even the police. He was also infamously filmed from the waist side up during the majority of his appearances on The Ed Sullivan Show. Little Richard, on the other hand, knew perfectly well about the graphic nature of his music and embraced it. The phrase rockin' and rollin', as featured in the song, was a slang expression for sex and was the basis of the term rock and roll itself. So, the genre as a whole wasn't exactly meant for consumption by kids in the first place. In addition to lyrical content, the PMRC was targeting controversial videos and suggestive album artwork, which brings me to another song titled Animal, Fuck Like a Beast by Wasp. The cover for the single featured a buzzsaw going through a man's crotch, and the song itself was targeted by the PMRC for its sexually violent content.
I got this glint in my eye whenever I'm performing, which keeps people off balance where they're asking, is he or isn't he serious about this? Those people have obviously never seen that glint. I mean, how can any grown man walk around with a 12-inch saw blade between his legs and take that seriously?
But the most laughable entry in the PMRC's Filthy 15 list is We're Not Gonna Take It by Twisted Sister. The reason for its inclusion on the list is because of its alleged violence. That's right. We're Not Gonna Take It, a simple rebellion anthem, was considered violent.
To me, to see these people can't see the humor. I mean, they can't see the cartoonishness of the whole thing. I mean, our main character is thrown out a window and he gets up and brushes himself off and he goes back for more. He's blown up with a hand grenade in a swimming pool, and the next scene, he's not even wet. This is a cartoon. Warner Brothers, Roadrunner, Bugs Bunny, Mickey Mouse has been doing this kind of violence for years. And we're the number one most violent band. I think they should crack down on Walt Disney.
In Tipper Gore's book, Raising PG Kids in an X-Rated Society, she claimed that young white males were most at risk for suicide. She also made the deduction that white males were also the target audience for heavy metal music. Wasp, the band singled out by the PMRC, received much attention, and the center's strong disdain for heavy metal may have contributed to its surge in popularity in the 80s. However, Blackie Lawless later confessed that their newly found infamy did not increase record sales, despite the fact that Wasp's inclusion in the list made them a household name. The PMRC have been supported by Mike Love from the Beach Boys and Joseph Kors, owner of Kors Beer, as well as religious organizations like the 700 Club and the Religious Booksellers Convention. However, they have denied any religious connections with these groups. By the way, it's worth noting that while the PMRC was bashing heavy metal, the artists themselves recorded a charity single to raise money to fight world hunger called Hearin' Aid. While it is a noble effort, it didn't erase heavy metal's bad reputation, but that wasn't the intention.
Ronnie James Dio, the man behind the Hearin' Aid Project, says good deeds aren't necessarily going to erase heavy metal's bad rap.
I just don't see it changing anything at all. Preconceived notions are very difficult to change.
And aside from that, we didn't do it for that reason. So maybe I can so unequivocally say that it's not going to happen because it doesn't matter.
On another note, Megadeth's 1986 song, Peace Sells, is frontman Dave Mustaine's way of dispelling many stereotypes about heavy metal bands, their fans, and heavy metal music in general. The song is saying heavy metal is not all anti-religion, anti-government, lazy and rude. But back to the PMRC. When accused of censorship, the PMRC vehemently denied it. As Susan Baker stated, pornography sold to children is illegal. Enforcing that is not censorship. It is simply the act of a responsible society that recognizes that some material made available to adults is not appropriate for children. Many artists and companies have strongly opposed the PMRC and their ridiculous demands.
Somehow, I really think that it's up to the radio station to do that. The idea of rating music is just doesn't sit well with me.
I'm very concerned that we're talking about some form of censorship here, which I absolutely do not believe in.
The RIAA initially refused to take any action, citing the First Amendment of the Constitution of the United States. However, on August 5th, 1985, Stanley Gordekoff, the president of the RIAA, wrote a letter to Pam Hauer stating that he agreed to issue all future albums with explicit content with a voluntarily applied sticker warning parents of the material on the record in an effort to appease the Senate in order to get approval for the Home Audio Recording Act. If passed, the bill would add a 1 cent tax for every minute on a blank cassette tape, as well as an additional 5-25% tax on all tape recorders in order to help alleviate the financial losses perpetrated by home recording and duplication. However, he refused to give in to their other demands. Gordekoff's decision was widely unwelcome by the recording industry, but nevertheless, under pressure from the RIAA, several record labels agreed to the proposal, with the exception of Geffen, MCA, A&M, and other smaller labels. Danny Goldberg, founder of Gold Mountain Records, formed an anti-censorship group called the Musical Majority, with several major artists, record executives, and managers who were also against the RIAA's labeling initiative. The term was a pun referring to the Puritan Christian group, the Moral Majority.
I empathize with parents who want to have influence over what their children hear, but the rating of records by some committee that would, by its nature, have to be arbitrary and subjective is not the proper solution to this problem.
Despite near universal opposition to the warning stickers, this practice was not uncommon. Before the PMRC and the PTA began demanding for universal music labeling, there have been a few artists who placed the warning labels on the album covers. This practice was common on comedy albums, especially from artists like Rick Dees, Eddie Murphy, and Richard Pryor. In an interview on Nightline, Donny Osmond had this to say about the PMRC's rating system efforts.
Go after what's cool. They're going to go to an R-rated movie before they go to a PG over a G, because it's cool. And if you censor it, it's going to be more cool to buy the hardcore lyrics.
I don't think the mother can stop the child from listening to the radio or watching TV.
Hey, why should they, put a limit to what I want to listen to? It's a free country. We can do whatever we want to do.
My parents, they don't like me listening to the music, but I explain to them that it's, just normal music.
It was around this time that the PMRC found a new enemy to grapple with, porn rock.
Here on videotape are some examples of what drives moms and dads up the wall.
It is like going to a porno movie and seeing everything. Only it's a porno hearing session, and the kids are hearing everything.
Complaints from parents and community leaders about rock music are as old as Johnny B. Goode. But the measures they're now taking to warn people about rock lyrics that might be offensive are brand new. And they're creating a huge discord in the music business.
Look out, heavy metal. There's a war going on. Not the mods versus the rockers, but the mothers versus the moguls. And we're not talking about the band, the Mothers of Invention, either.
We just want people to know what's going on. And we have asked the music industry, please,
rate these albums so we can protect our young children from trash like this. When they got the record home, the Purple Rain album had Darling Nikki, which is a song about, well, I met a girl named Nikki. Guess you could say she was a sex fiend. I met her in a hotel lobby masturbating with a magazine.
Songs about glorifying incest. There's songs about rape, thrill killing, sadomasochism. There's a song that goes, quote, not a woman but a whore. I can taste the hate. Well, now I'm killing you. Watch your face turning blue, unquote. By a group that has sold 2 million copies of that particular album. They're very popular with young kids.
They say, oh, they're bad, they're evil. But we're not bad, we're not evil. We're just creating great music, and we're having a really good time. But obviously, it's just like with Elvis Presley. I mean, look, they went and photographed him from the crotch down, right?
But perhaps the most vocal critic of the PMRC was none other than Frank Zappa.
I mean, if it looks like censorship and it smells like censorship, it is censorship, no matter whose wife is talking about it. It's censorship.
Zappa, whose own discography defiantly blurred the lines between rock, jazz, and classical music, saw himself as a constitutional fundamentalist who believed what the PMRC was suggesting was nothing more than the beginning of watered-down censorship, which he believed to be in direct conflict with his First Amendment rights as both an artist and a performer. He criticized Gordakov's decision to voluntarily label explicit albums, as he wrote in his open letter to the music industry, which was published in the magazine Cashbox. If you're an artist reading this, think for a moment. Did anyone ask you if you wanted to have the stigma of potential filth plopped onto your next release via this appeasement sticker? If you are a songwriter, did anyone ask you if you wanted to spend the rest of your career modifying your lyrical content to suit the spiritual needs of an imaginary 11-year-old? The answer is, obviously no. In all of this, the main concern has been the business agenda of the major labels versus the egos and sexual neuroses of these vigilant ladies. A record company has the right to conduct its business and to make a profit, but not at the expense of the people who make the product possible. Someone has to write and perform the music. The RIAA has taken what I feel to be a short-sighted approach to the issue. The voluntary sticker will not appease these creatures, nor will it grease the chute through the Thurman Committee. There are no promises or guarantees here, only threats and insinuations from the PMRC. A year before the inception of the PMRC, Frank Zappa began releasing albums on his own Barking Pumpkin record label with his own advisory sticker that criticized televangelists that were gaining popularity throughout the 80s, in addition to referencing the content of the album. Much of Zappa's back catalog tackles controversial subjects and contains explicit lyrics. His 1984 album, Think Fish in particular, contains lyrics that are arguably more obscene than anything on the Filthy 15. Zappa appeared on various radio and TV broadcasts and participated in numerous debates.
Do you think at all that you would not want to have either in music video or on records, or any line that you wouldn't want to see crossed, to perhaps that your children might be exposed to?
Well, I believe that a child deserves a good sexual education, and matters pertaining to sex should not be kept from children, because if you keep them sexually ignorant, you make them vulnerable to child molesters. And I think it's important that children learn as soon as they're capable of understanding, with the assistance of a parent, and there are plenty of good textbooks that are available for children that explain the mechanics of sex. They should know about sex, and they should be prepared to deal with it. Just because somebody makes mention of sexual practices in a movie or on a record or in a book or any form of entertainment, there's nothing to be afraid of if you've taken the time to educate your children. You know, I believe it's the attitude of the PMRC is somewhere on the same line as those kind of people who demand that sexual education be taken out of schools. It's foolish.
In a pre-recorded debate, which aired on August 25th, 1985, Zappa appeared on a debate with PMRC spokesperson Candy Stroud on CBS Nightmatch.
I have three children, and I believe that they should be protected from violent and pornographic rock, and that it is the responsibility of the music industry to reform itself.
Arguing against the resolution, singer, songwriter, one of the more unorthodox performers of rock and roll, and the father of four children, Frank Zappa.
Frogwash, I say. Censorship is bad for you, and sex is good for you.
During the debate, Stroud relied heavily on citing controversial lyrics in order to get her point across, knowing fully well that there are children in the audience.
Don't let anybody tell you that the music of the 60s and 70s is the same as the music of the 80s. Times have changed, the barriers have fallen. innuendo has given way to the explicit, graphic, violent, pornographic. In the 50s, Elvis Presley sang, I want you, I need you, I love you, or come along and be my teddy bear. Now, Morris Day in the Times sings, if the kid can't make you come, nobody can. I want to get you off, baby. What does it take to get you off? In the 50s, Little Richard sang, good golly, Miss Molly, you sure know how to ball. Now Prince sings, I met a girl named Nikki. I guess you could say she was a sex fiend. I met her in a hotel lobby masturbating with a magazine. And Sheena Easton sings, sugar walls. While I abhor censorship and I believe that banning creativity is wrong, I do think that the time has come for the music industry to exercise its social responsibility and police itself.
Your opening statement, Mr. Zappa.
I do not speak for the music industry, nor would they wish me to. I do not approve of most of what is being manufactured for entertainment, but I do not feel that it is my place or anyone else's place to keep a type of entertainment that people desire from them. I don't know very much about Candy Stroud or her cause. I find it fascinating. I find that I've just read this little reprint of her Newsweek thing just before I came over here, and I feel sorry for her that anybody could respond that way to matters pertaining to sex. And I don't really have a statement to make about this because I need to know more about what it is you're really trying to say, because it's not very clear. You've quoted from songs, but you don't say exactly what it is about these quotations that are so offensive to you.
Well, to answer your question, Frank, I think that sex is healthy, but it's not an animal act. And that the message that rock stars are singing today is that love equals sex and sex equals love, that love is purely recreational, it's a thing that is fun, there are no commitments, no responsibilities, and no consequences. As Tina Turner sings, what's love got to do with it? Love is only a secondhand emotion. That is a message that is being preached over and over again to teenagers at a time when they're forming their value systems and their morals. It's not just the mainstream rock music, but it's rock music that is in the heavy metal industry, for example, where you have songs that deal with forcing a woman to have oral sex at gunpoint, as in Judas Priest on the album Defenders of the Faith, Eat Me Alive, in which he sings, sounds like an animal panting to the beat, groan in the pleasure zone, gasping from the heat, gut-wrenching frenzy that deranges every joint. I'm going to force you at gunpoint to eat me alive.
Hey, I can see why some of this stuff rubs you the wrong way, because you have a problem with sex. The lyrics that you're talking about contain some words that seem to trigger this peculiar response. Can we narrow those down and talk about those words? Because you're talking here about rating different types of bad rock music, completely ignoring what goes on in country and western, which also has sexual lyrics. You're picking on rock. You're ignoring the fact that many classical pieces have texts which are pornographic.
She, for an hour, recited the lyrics to every song that talked about masturbation, giving head at gunpoint, you know, all this kind of stuff, without, I believe, without publishing clearance from the groups in question, you know, which I don't think is very fair.
I'm glad that you're very unorthodox, because a lot of the lyrics are perverted sex. They're not normal. And maybe you don't realize that, but I think the parents would like to know that some of those things are not normal sexual relations.
But that doesn't mean that you have to do them. You should know about them. Information doesn't kill
children
you.
Children don't know the difference.
Children learn.
Taught.
Children learn the difference by receiving information, which they can store and sort with your help as a parent. If you don't let them know about this stuff, they'll grow up and be ignorant.
I would rather have them be ignorant of something.
Anybody who chooses to have their children be ignorant is making a mistake, because then they can be victims. They have to know.
The show was supposed to be a one-hour debate, and all the commercials were rolled in, and all the video clips were rolled in. It was done in front of a live audience, and we had conversations with the audience, and the show was taped a week in advance, and I thought everything was fine. Okay, but they held the show back for a week, and they cut out most of what I said, and the show wound up being
maybe about a half an hour long, and the whole structure of the show was changed. And I thought, wait a minute, somebody doesn't want to hear what I got to say here. And I started doing some checking, and I got really mad. And I also heard that even at that time that they were planning on having a hearing in front of the Senate. And at that time it was supposed to be in front of the Goldwater Communications Subcommittee. So I had my lawyer call Goldwater's office and say I would like to attend.
It was a big year in metal news. Some people want to make heavy metal an endangered species, but we wouldn't let it, would we? No, the issue was record ratings proposed by the PMRC.
The PMRC hearing was held before the Senate Commerce, Science, and Transportation Committee on September 19, 1985. Among those testifying were some of the more prominent representatives of the PMRC, including Tipper Gore, Susan Baker, and Reverend Jeff Ling, musicians John Denver, Dee Snider of Twisted Sister, and of course, Frank Zappa, all stepped up to the plate to testify before the Senate. Now, John Denver was the wild card testimony for the PMRC because he was considered such a tame artist.
You know what worries me about what's happening here today? This is government as entertainment. These people have plenty to do besides talking about whether or not somebody's little Johnny gets to see the Blackie Lawless cover with a buzzsaw blade between his legs.
The reason for this hearing is not to promote any legislation. Indeed, I don't know of any suggestion that any legislation be passed. But to simply provide a forum for airing the issue itself, for ventilating the issue, for bringing it out in the public domain. The concern is that the public at large should be aware of the existence of this kind of music and the fact that it is now available to kids and that kids of all ages are able to buy it.
Senator Paula Hawkins presented three record covers, including Def Leppard's Pyromania, Wow by Wendy O. Williams, and Wasp's Animal Fuck Like a Beast, which was on the PMRC's Filthy 15 list, as well as the music videos for Twisted Sister's We're Not Gonna Take It and Van Halen's Hot for Teacher.
Much has changed since Elvis' seemingly innocent times. Subtleties, suggestions, and innuendo have given way to overt expressions and descriptions of often violent sexual acts, drug taking, and flirtations with the occult. The record album covers, to me, are self-explanatory.
The next person to testify was Reverend Jeff Ling, who also described himself as a youth counselor. Ling has searched through record stores to amass one of the country's most complete collection of raunchy rock albums, which he presented at the hearing, as well as describing the contents of the said albums.
That what you are about to see and hear is a small sample of the abundant material available today. Today, the element of violence, brutal erotica, has exploded in rock music in an unprecedented way. Many albums today include songs that encourage suicide, violent revenge, sexual violence, and violence just for violence's sake. Suicide has become epidemic in our country among teenagers. Some 6,000 will take their lives this year. Many of these young people will find encouragement from some rock stars who present death as a positive, almost attractive alternative. The album I'm holding up in front of you is by the band Metallica. It's on Elektra Asylum Records. A song on this album is called Fade to Black and says the following: I have lost the will to live. Simply nothing more to give. There is nothing more for me. I need the end to set me free. Death greets me warm. I will just say goodbye.
Wow, that's the biggest misconception if I've ever heard one. Jeff Ling really got it wrong here. Now, here's a little background for you. Metallica wrote the song Fade to Black after their equipment was stolen in early 84, and they had to start all over again. More specifically, Jeff Hetfield wrote the lyrics in response to one of his amps being stolen. Not only was this amp his favorite, but it was also the first amp he ever owned, so it had a lot of sentimental value to him. The song itself is about losing everything and wondering if life is even worth living anymore. In the last two verses of the song, the person realizes that life is too good to let go, but by that time, it's too late. The song has actually prevented people from killing themselves. In fact, the band received hundreds of letters from kids telling them how they related to the song and that it made them feel better. But then again, when you're associated with an authoritarian group, the context and artistic intent of a song don't matter now, do they?
Alrighty, this is Betsy. She's the lead singer of a band called Bitch. The album is called Be My Slave and is available in record stores. One of the songs is called Give Me a Kiss. The way you grab me makes my knees shake. The way you pull my arms makes my body quake. The way you yank my hair, it just makes me want to kill you. I'll take off my clothes, kick me in the shins, come on and slap me in the face, and I'll get down on my knees and move you like this. And the song Leatherbound. The whip is my toy, handcuffs are your joy. You hold me down and I'm screaming for more. When you tie me up and gag me, the way you give me pain, come on, give me lashes. How bad can it get? The list is endless. This album was released just recently by a band called The Mentors. It was released on the label Enigma Records, which also launched Motley Crue's career. The album includes songs like 4F Club, Finder, Feeler, Fucker, and Forgetter. Free Fix for a Fuck, Clap Queen, My Erection is Over, and the song Golden Showers, which says these words, listen, you little slut, do as you are told, come with daddy for me to pour the gold. Golden showers, all through my excrements you shall roam, bend up and smell my anal vapor, your face is my toilet paper, on your face I leave a shit tower, golden showers.
Okay, Jeff Ling's presentation was completely dishonest, because it lumped in the obviously explicit material of obscure heavy metal acts with the more subjective lyrics of major acts like Metallica and Prince. According to the RIAA, 7 of the 15 or so groups presented by Ling, Wasp, Morris Day and the Time, Bitch, Mentors, Abattoir, Impaler, and Piledriver, did not go gold. As Frank Zappa took the witness stand moments later, he asked whether the committee was considering legislation. Senator Danworth had this to say.
You understand that the previous witnesses were not asking for legislation, and I don't know, I can't speak for Senator Hollings, but I think that the prevailing view here is that nobody's asking for legislation. The question is just focusing on what a lot of people perceive to be a problem, and you've indicated that you at least understand that there is another point of view.
Yeah, I do understand.
And that there are people who think that, you know, parents should have some knowledge of what goes into their home.
Some of the senators, however, were in a legislative mood, despite Danworth's claims. Senator J. James Exon had this to say.
Yes.
This is one senator that might be interested in legislation and or regulation to some extent, recognizing the problems with free right of expression and my previously expressed views that I don't believe I should be telling other people what they have to listen to. Mm-hmm. But I really believe that the suggestions made by the original panel was some kind of an arrangement for voluntarily policing this in the music industry is the correct way to go. Mm-hmm. So if it'll help you out in your testimony, I might join Senator Hollings and or others in some kind of legislation and or regulation, unless the free enterprise system, both the producers and you as the performers, see fit to clean up your act.
Zappa responded by comparing the PMRC to treating dandruff by decapitation.
No one has forced Mrs. Baker or Mrs. Gore to bring Prince or Sheena Easton into their homes. Thanks to the Constitution, they are free to buy other forms of music for their children. Apparently, they insist on purchasing the works of contemporary recording artists in order to support a personal illusion of aerobic sophistication. Ladies, please be advised, the $8.98 purchase price does not entitle you to a kiss on the foot from the composer or performer in exchange for a spin on the family Victrola. Taken as a whole, the complete list of PMRC demands reads like an instruction manual for some sinister kind of toilet training program to housebreak all composers and performers because of the lyrics of a few. Ladies, how dare you? The ladies' shame must be shared by the bosses of the major labels who, through the RIAA, chose to bargain away the rights of composers, performers, and retailers in order to pass HR 2911, the blank tape tax. A private tax levied by an industry on consumers for the benefit of a select group within that industry. Is this a consumer issue? You bet it is. Their secretary told me on the phone last Friday that the PMRC has no members, only founders. I asked how many other DC wives are non-members of an organization that raises money by mail
has a tax-exempt status and seems intent on running the Constitution of the United States through the family paper shredder. I asked her if it was a cult. Finally, she said she couldn't give me an answer and that she had to call their lawyer. Is the basic issue morality? Is it mental health? Is it an issue at all? The PMRC has created a lot of confusion with improper comparisons between song lyrics, videos, record packaging, radio broadcasting, and live performances. These are all different mediums, and the people who work in them have a right to conduct their business without trade restraining legislation whipped up like an instant pudding by the wives of Big Brother. Is it proper that the husband of a PMRC non-member founder person sits on any committee considering business pertaining to the blank tape tax or his wife's lobbying organization? Can any committee thus constituted find facts in a fair and unbiased manner? This committee has three that we know about, Senator Danforth, Senator Packwood, and Senator Gore. For some reason, they seem to feel there is no conflict of interest involved. Children in the vulnerable age bracket have a natural love for music. If, as a parent, you believe they should be exposed to something more uplifting than sugar walls, support music appreciation programs in schools. Why haven't you considered your child's need for consumer information? Music appreciation costs very little compared to sports expenditures. Your children have a right to know that something besides pop music exists. It is unfortunate that the PMRC would rather dispense governmentally sanitized heavy metal music than something more uplifting. Is this an indication of PMRC's personal taste, or just another manifestation of the low priority this administration has placed on education for the arts in America? The answer, of course, is neither. You can't distract people from thinking about an unfair tax by talking about music appreciation. For that, you need sex, and lots of it. The establishment of a rating system, voluntary or otherwise, opens the door to an endless parade of moral quality control programs based on things certain Christians don't like. What if the next bunch of Washington wives demands a large yellow J on all material written or performed by Jews in order to save helpless children from exposure to concealed Zionist doctrine? Record ratings are frequently compared to film ratings. Apart from the quantitative difference, there is another that is more important. People who act in films are hired to pretend. No matter how the film is rated, it won't hurt them personally. Since many musicians write and perform their own material and stand by it as their art, whether you like it or not, an imposed rating will stigmatize them as individuals. How long before composers and performers are told to wear a festive little PMRC armband with their scarlet letter on it? Bad facts make bad law, and people who write bad laws are, in my opinion, more dangerous than songwriters who celebrate sexuality. Freedom of speech, freedom of religious thought, and the right to due process for composers, performers, and retailers are imperiled if the PMRC and the major labels consummate this nasty bargain.
Next on the stand was John Denver. He said he commended the PMRC for their concerns, but he was opposed to any kind of music rating system.
Discipline and self-restraint, when practiced by an individual, a family, or a company, is an effective way to deal with this issue. The same thing when forced on a people by their government, or worse, by a self-appointed watchdog of public morals, is suppression and will not be tolerated in a democratic society. Mr. Chairman, the suppression of a people, of a society, begins, in my mind, with the censorship of the written or spoken word. It was so in Nazi Germany, it is so in many places today where those in power are afraid of the consequences of an informed and educated people. In a mature and incredibly diverse society such as ours, the access to all perspectives of an issue becomes more and more important. Those things which in our experience are undesirable generally prove to be unfurthering and sooner or later become boring. That process cannot and should not be stifled. On the other hand, that which is denied becomes that which is most interesting. That which is denied becomes that which is most desired, and that which is hidden becomes that which is most interesting. Consequently, a great deal of time and energy is spent trying to get at what is being kept from you. Our children, our people, our society, and the world cannot afford this waste. It was my pleasure to meet with radio programmers and broadcasters from all over the country this past week in Dallas. They expressed their concern about this issue and the direction in which it seemed to be going. They also expressed their willingness to practice the discipline and self-restraint that I mentioned earlier, especially when they were given direction by their listeners. Now, I believe this to be true because they're in business to please their listening audience. I would like to acknowledge the PMRC for bringing this issue to the attention of not only our industry, but our government and our people. It is obvious that we are dealing with a real problem which warrants our concern. I would like to point out, however, that we address ourselves not to the problem, but to the symptoms. I suggest that explicit lyrics and graphic videos are not so far removed from what is seen on television every day and night, whether it be in the soap operas or on the news. That we should point our finger at the recording industry while watching the general public at a nationally televised baseball game chant in unison, "The Blue Jays suck," is ludicrous. The problem, Mr. Chairman, in my opinion, has to do with our willingness as parents to take responsibility for the upbringing of our children, to pay attention to their interest, to respond to their needs, and to recognize that we as parents and as individuals have a greater influence on our children and on each other than anything else could possibly have. To quote a wise old man from ancient China, if there be righteousness, not self-righteousness, that's not part of the quote. If there be righteousness in the heart, there will be beauty in the character. If there be beauty in the character, there will be harmony in the home. If there be harmony in the home, there will be order in the nation. And if there be order in the nation, there will be peace in the world. I thank you very much. In my experience, sir, all over the world, one of the most interesting things about the music that that young people are listening to is it gives us as adults a very clear insight as to what is going on in their minds. We can know what they're thinking by listening to the music that they surround themselves with. The people that I've had the opportunity to talk with, the troubled children, the teenagers who are considering suicide, what they express to me is a real frustration in their lives, an inability to communicate with their parents, an inability to understand or to envision any kind of a possible future because of the nuclear threat that we live under. They don't see things getting better economically. They don't see things getting better for the small businessman, for the small farmer. They do not see a future for themselves. It is my opinion that it is out of this that some young people put a gun into their mouths and pull the trigger. We can turn this around, sir. We can address the reality of a problem and not deal with just the symptoms and create not only a better world for our children, but for ourselves and all of humanity. We can end hunger. We can rid the world of nuclear weapons. We can learn to live together as human beings on a planet that travels through the universe, living the example of peace and harmony among all.
After Denver's testimony, this is where Twisted Sister frontman Dee Snider comes in. He blew into the hearing room looking like a metalhead and actually said sick motherfucking fans of Twisted Sister in front of the Senate. This guy is a total badass. For Snider, it was a chance to show the world that he wasn't the dumb, aggressive metalhead palooka he felt the PMRC thought he was. As footage of his testimony shows, the senators present, including Al Gore, were not ready for him. Snider was a sober family man who could spar with the senators, speak to responsible parenting, and defend his lyrics against the PMRC's surreal interpretations.
Since I seem to be the only person addressing this committee today who has been a direct target of accusations from the presumably responsible PMRC, I would like to use this occasion to speak on a more personal note and show just how unfair the whole concept of lyrical interpretation and judgment can be, and how many times this can amount to little more than character assassination. I have taken the liberty of distributing to you material and lyrics pertaining to these accusations. There were three attacks in particular which I would like to address. Accusation number one. This attack was contained in an article written by Tipper Gore, which was given the form of a full page in my hometown newspaper on Long Island. In this article, Ms. Gore claimed that one of my songs, Under the Blade, had lyrics encouraging sadomasochism, bondage, and rape. The lyrics she quoted have absolutely nothing to do with these topics. On the contrary, The words in question are about surgery and the fear that it instills in people. Furthermore, the reader of this article is led to believe that the three lines she quotes go together in the song, when, as you can see from reading the lyrics, the first two lines she cites are an edited phrase from the second verse, and the third line is a misquote of a line from the chorus. That the writer could misquote me is curious, since we make it a point to print all our lyrics on the inner sleeve of every album. As the creator of Under the Blade, I can say categorically that the only sadomasochism, bondage, and rape in this song is in the mind of Ms. Gore. Accusation number two. The PMRC has made public a list of 15 of what they feel are some of the most blatant songs lyrically. On this list is our song, We're Not Gonna Take It, upon which has been bestowed a V rating indicating violent lyrical content. You'll note from the lyrics before you that there is absolutely no violence of any type either sung about or implied anywhere in the song. Now, it strikes me that the PMRC may have confused our video presentation for this song with the meaning of the lyrics. It's no secret that videos often depict storylines completely unrelated to the lyrics of the song they accompany. The video for We're Not Gonna Take It was simply meant to be a cartoon with human actors playing variations on the Roadrunner Wile E. Coyote theme. Each stunt was selected from my extensive personal collection of cartoons. You'll note when you watch the entire video that after each catastrophe our villain suffers through, in the next sequence he reappears unharmed by any previous attack, no worse for the wear. By the way, I'm very pleased to note that the United Way of America has been granted a request to use portions of our We're Not Gonna Take It video in a program they are producing on the subject of the changing American family. They asked for it because of its, quote, lighthearted way of talking about communicating with teenagers, unquote. It is gratifying that an organization as respected as the United Way of America appreciates where we're coming from. I've included a copy of the United Way's request as part of my written testimony. Thank you, United Way. Accusation number three. Last Tuesday, a public forum regarding the lyric controversy was held in New York. Among the panelists was Ms. Gore. Trying to stem the virtual tidal wave of anti-rating sentiment coming from the audience, Ms. Gore made the following statement, quote, I agree this is a small percentage of all music, thank goodness, but it's becoming more mainstream. You look at even the t-shirts the kids are wearing, and you see Twisted Sister and a woman in handcuffs sort of spread-eagled, unquote. This is an outright lie. Not only have we never sold a shirt of this type, we have always taken great pains to steer clear of sexism in our merchandise, records, stage show, and personal lives. Furthermore, we have always promoted the belief that rock and roll should not be sexist, but should cater to males and females equally. I feel that an accusation of this type is irresponsible, damaging to our reputation, and slanderous. I defy Ms. Gore, to produce such a shirt to back up her claim. I'm tired of running into kids on the street who tell me that they can't play our records anymore because of the misinformation their parents are being fed by the PMRC on TV and in the newspapers. These are the only three accusations I've come across. All three are totally unfounded. Who knows what other false and irresponsible things have been said about me or my band. There happens to be one area where I'm in complete agreement with the PMRC, as well as the National PTA, and probably most of the parents on this committee. That is, it is my job as a parent to monitor what my children see, hear, and read during their preteen years. The full responsibility for this falls on the shoulders of my wife and I, because there is no one else capable of making these judgments for us. Parents can thank the PMRC for reminding them that there is no substitute for parental guidance, but that is where the PMRC's job ends. The beauty of literature, poetry, and music is that they leave room for the audience to put its own imagination, experiences, and dreams into the words. The examples I cited earlier showed clear evidence of Twisted Sister's music being completely misinterpreted and unfairly judged by supposedly well-informed adults. We cannot allow this to continue. There is no authority who has the right or the necessary insight to make these judgments. Not myself, not the federal government, not some recording industry committee, not the PTA, not the RIAA, and certainly not the PMRC. I'd like to thank the committee for this time, and I hope my testimony will aid you in clearing up this issue.
Thank you, Mr. Snyder.
On November 1st, 1985, the RIAA agreed to put parental advisory labels on selected releases at their own discretion. The labels were generic, unlike the original idea of a descriptive label categorizing the explicit lyrics. The PMRC, PTA, and RIAA agreed to monitor the situation closely for a year and assess the results of a new labeling system. According to Tipper Gore, she considered only 5% of the total records sold offensive. However, due to the nature of the agreement and the low number of explicit records produced, only a minuscule number of albums received parental advisory labels over the year of its inception. Additionally, some albums containing explicit content were released on independent labels that weren't members of the RIAA, thusly excluded from the agreement. On December 10, 1986, the PMRC denounced the RIAA for allegedly failing to comply with the agreement and sent another spurt of letters to record labels complaining that the warning labels were too small and only made it harder to control explicit releases. Because of the impact of the PMRC, negative effects due to labeling were witnessed. Joanne McDuffie, lead singer of the Mary Jane Girls, stated that the parental advisory label prevented the group from being considered for awards and held the group back from topping the charts. Sheena Easton's song Sugar Walls was banned from several radio stations, and she was forbidden from performing the song on American Bandstand. And Blackie Lawless of Wasp confessed that as a result of the exposure he had received due to the PMRC's efforts, he had received death threats and vehicular sabotage. Many artists have written songs criticizing the PMRC and Tipper Gore. One example is Danzig's 1988 single, Mother, which is the most famous song about the PMRC labeling and its inherent problems.
Mother, tell your children not to walk my way. Tell your children not to hear my words, what they mean, what they say, Mother.
It's also worth noting that Danzig's self-titled debut album, in which the song appears, also got slapped with the parental advisory label, which is funny because Danzig's album had absolutely no profanity or sexual or drug and alcohol references whatsoever. As Glenn Danzig was looking back at the album, he stated that he said some stuff that the PMRC found offensive. He questioned religion and the government, and that's a major no-no in the PMRC's eyes, because we can't have the kiddies questioning authority or religion now, can we? Megadeth's song, Hook and Mouth, from their 1988 album, So Far So Good So What, is aimed at the PMRC. But the most damning condemnation of the PMRC by any performer is Ice-T's 1989 album, The Iceberg / Freedom of Speech, Just Watch What You Say, which contains many criticisms of the PMRC. One track in particular, Freedom of Speech, is an extended attack on Tipper Gore.
What's the matter? You ain't getting no dick, you bitching about rock and roll. That's such a shit, dumb bitch. The Constitution say we all got a right to speak. Say what we want, Tip. Your argument is weak.
How about talking out on the other issues that have impact on your industry?
I can put it all in a nutshell. The enemies of the music is what fuels the fire. As soon as a kid comes home from school and his mother says, have you listened to your Ice-T album today? I'm through. Rock and roll has always got to have an enemy. That's what keeps it rock and roll. So what is it?
In his book, The Ice Opinion, Ice-T wrote, Tipper Gore is the only woman I ever directly called a bitch on any of my records, and I meant that in the most negative sense of the word. Notable snippets of audio from the Senate hearing found their way into Frank Zappa's audio collage, Porn Wars, released on Zappa's Mothers of Prevention album. The album cover featured a parody of the RIAA warning label. As for the blank tape tax, it received a committee hearing before the Senate on October 30th, 1985. However, after a few more hearings, the bill was ultimately rejected. In July 1990, under burgeoning pressure from 19 states who were discussing legal requirements and censorship bills, a new, more definitive consensus was reached, which established a standardized black and white design and size of the warning label. It was displayed on either the lower right or left of the album jacket or CD or cassette cover, or would either be printed on the actual cover of explicit albums.
The uniform logo will enhance the existing voluntary system and better respond to the legitimate concerns of parents and retailers.
We don't think that the government should determine what our children listen to, and I mean that as an artist and also as a parent. I think it's more of a parent's responsibility. We don't think that politicians have that power to determine what our children listen to. And we also think that the label is cute.
The very first album to bear this new parental advisory warning label was Banned in the USA by Two Live Crew, whose album, As Nasty as They Wanna Be, was deemed illegal in certain counties of Florida because of its sexually explicit content. They actually released an edited version of the album titled As Clean as They Wanna Be, which featured no explicit lyrics. For the past 25 years, under the suggestion of the RIAA, voluntary labeling of albums with lyrics containing frequent profanity or depictions of sex, violence, and substance abuse to the extent of meriting parental notification has become mandatory. The effects of the warning label have often been debated. Some have even proclaimed that the label has encouraged younger listeners to purchase albums with what is often referred to as a tipper sticker. In response to later hearings in the following years, it was reworded as parental advisory, explicit content. The sticker itself has become somewhat of a symbol of rebellion. It became most associated with the rap and hip-hop genre, which ultimately took over for heavy metal as the genre of music condemned by parents and authoritarians. Many retailers, like Walmart, won't stock explicit albums. However, other retailers like Best Buy and Target carry both edited and explicit albums. Since 2015, digital providers such as iTunes and Spotify tag tracks as explicit if they have been identified as such. This frequently includes tracks from older albums that predate the use of the label or were released afterwards but do not feature the label on physical releases. As for the PMRC, their influence waned throughout the late 80s and early 90s. Tipper Gore resigned from the group and became Second Lady of the United States. Despite their veritable inusitation, the PMRC's historical influence on the music industry hasn't been forgotten.
In 1984, when Peace Sells But Who's Buying was getting ready to come out, we had been told that we were going to get a sticker on our record. And we voluntarily put the sticker on our record. And it was because of some of the lyrics on the record that Tipper Gore didn't like. And by the time that the second record came out, which was our third record. The first one didn't get stickered. The third record, So Far So Good So What, which was the second one to get stickered. By the time that came out, I had already written a song called Hook and Mouth because I was really pretty pissed off that this vice president's wife would be telling us what we need to listen to. And besides, she's a Democrat. I can't even understand somebody who's supposed to be championing liberties for democracy and somebody who's supposed to be on the more liberal side of politics would want to tell us what we can listen to. Frankly, I think that it was really a terrible period in music business, and I'm glad that the PMRC is gone.
Due to its prominence in the music industry, the parental advisory label has relatively become a necessary evil and hasn't prevented artists from reaching mainstream popularity or expressing themselves more explicitly. The world becomes an increasingly ugly place with each passing decade, and the media we consume, whether it be music, movies, TV, or otherwise, is going to reflect our worldview, for better or for worse. Now, when people, especially authoritarians, try to make justifications for censorship or taking away your freedom, they'll usually tell you the same lie they always tell you. They'll say that they're protecting people, but what they won't tell you is that those people are only limited to themselves. In this case, the PMRC claimed to protect children from heavy metal music, but they tried to suppress heavy metal to protect themselves so they don't have to talk to their children about anything. in this day and age, especially considering the fact that we're living in the age of the internet, where just about any source of information can be discovered by anyone, censorship and suppression is still going strong. In Virginia, you can get fined $1 just for swearing in public. In London, you can get arrested for what you post on Facebook and Twitter. In 2010 alone, 625 people were detained for allegedly sending offensive messages via social media. PayPal even bans people from using their service just for their political beliefs. And it really raises questions. How is Carlos Maza any different from Tipper Gore? How are the accusations of glorifying the occult, violence, etc. any different from accusations of sexism without any basis? How is the PMRC getting a hearing from the US Senate any different from Anita Sarkeesian and Zoe Quinn going to the UN demanding internet censorship? And how is 60 Minutes spreading misinformation about conservatives on YouTube and then interviewing Susan Wojcicki to demand more censorship the same as Jeff Ling spreading misinformation about Metallica's music at the PMRC Senate hearing? Simple. They were looking for bad things, and they found bad things, despite the fact that their claims have absolutely no basis in reality. Authoritarianism is contemptible, pure and simple.
How much are you going to miss out on the United States if you won't let people think, say what they think, and do something about it so that people who don't think and are too busy doing something else can have the benefit of the people who think?